Good morning, church. It's good to see you. What a great day it is to be in the house of the Lord. Would you stand as we sing, as we start off our service with some worship?
I was buried beneath my shame.
Spend the day with us. You are welcome here. You're our guest. You are not a stranger if you've been in here even once. So we want to welcome you today. If you just take a couple of seconds and greet somebody and tell them that, good to see you.
Church family, let's go ahead and have a seat, please. That's one time that I really wish that you all could stand up here for a minute and see what I do. It's just so good to see the smiles and the embraces and all the warm hugs and handshakes on the Lord's Day this Sunday morning, and a beautiful day that it is. It's also a special day in our nation, not because it's National Brisket Day, I know that's what some of you are thinking, but because we are really remembering today people, servicemen and women throughout the years that have given their lives, and family members that now live with their memory and the impact that they've had on their own families and on our nation as a whole for having given the ultimate price, fallen, so many of them on the battlefield. And so we want to recognize that today along with our fellow citizens. And as we have our prayer just a few moments, part of that will be a prayer of thanksgiving for the freedoms that they have, and also a prayer of support for all of those family members that are still carrying on. I've been told by many of them that it can be decades after they receive that letter or visit or phone call, or back in the day, telegram, but it doesn't matter, it's still fresh every time they think about it, and especially this weekend as we remember all of them. And so we'll do that in a few moments. And also, right after our prayer time, of course, we demonstrate our stewardship by tithes and offerings. So we'll have that as a time of thanksgiving. Please remember that we need your help during that time. So during the next portion of worship that we have, if y'all would just lean down to, most of y'all, it's in the right balcony. It's just the nearest basket. If you would, grab that offering basket the closest to you and pass it. Even if you gave through small groups and Bible study and Sunday school this morning, somebody else may not have. So please help us by passing that down the row. And then some of our men, Johnny and some others, will come along and gather up those baskets. And as always, man, thank you all for being faithful in that way. When there's several things that are going on in our church family this week, there's ladies' Bible studies, men's Bible studies, and some other gatherings and emphases. So please take a few moments and familiarize yourself with those, and that'll be good as well. And then one more thing before we have that time of prayer, and that is that Paige and I are so blessed today to have several of our family members here, and I think you've met some of them, but I don't know if you remember, so I just want to take a second and mention that. So Hope is Paige's sister, and then Bradley, her husband. Their son Benjamin is right back here in the choir singing there for Paige today. Yeah, thank you. Give them all a pleasure to welcome Paige. Amen. And then in just a little while, the one that some would say is the best preacher in the family, Dr. Gene Henderson, Paige's dad, will be bringing the message from God's Word today. Others, of course, would say that Paige is that person. So you and I might vote for her, I suppose. But we are so grateful to have Dr. Gene today. It's been a long, long time since I've been able to sit and be ministered to by him from God's Word, and I'm really looking forward to that treat today. So at the proper time, he'll come up and be sharing with us a message from God's Word. Amen? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, for all of these reasons, we want to bless you, Father. We want to bless you, Lord, today for the freedoms that we have in our nation, especially the freedom to gather as we have this morning and worship the living God. So in the name of Jesus, that's exactly what we're doing today, Father, proclaiming him to be King of kings and Lord of lords, and to have the name that is above all names. Father, we are also truly grateful for the servicemen and women who even now are serving all around the world, and many of them, even as we speak and experience our freedoms today, there are some that are in the line of fire who are fighting for that freedom. Lord, your word says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And so I pray that we would embrace those freedoms, not as an end of themselves, but as a means to spread the gospel, not only throughout North America, but to the ends of the earth. And we also realize, Lord, that there are people that are experiencing a different kind of battlefield and a different kind of warfare today, who see their sole purpose as spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they're in harm's way today. Many of them are risking their lives. And so we pray, Father, according to your will, a hedge of protection around them, but even more importantly, a harvest of souls as a result of their work. Father, for all the men and women and young people that have had family members in years past or days past that have gone on into eternity and who've paid the ultimate price for freedom with their lives, I pray you minister to those families. I pray, Father, that you would give them a good support system, that you would encourage them, and that they would not grieve as those who have no hope, but that your Holy Spirit would come alongside of them and to comfort them. Father, in the days ahead, no doubt, there will still be people who pay that ultimate price. And I pray, Father, that as that happens, you'll allow us never to take those freedoms and that price for granted. Thank you most of all, Father, that Jesus paid the price for our sins when he died on that cross for us so long ago. And it's in his name that we pray, and his glorious resurrection that we live. Amen.
Who helps when mothers cry out to us?
deserves all the praise and all the glory. He died and he rose, and we will sing his song forever. Would you stand as we worship? This is an older song, but it still rings true today.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, who then shall I?
Because what Jesus did for us on Calvary, There is nothing we can do to earn God's grace. We can't buy it. We can't work hard enough for it. It is the gift of God, an eternal life. Jesus did everything he needed to do on the cross. And when he rose from the dead, that sealed the promise. Amen. Man, that's just good news, no matter how you slice it. How deep the Father's love for us.
Through it all, my
thank you that it is well with our soul. Demons can come screaming, but the gates of hell will not prevail against us. Those that have been washed in the blood. Lord, today we just give you thanks. Lord, help us to keep our eyes on you, because you still control the wind and the storms. In our behalf, mountains will be moved because of our sake. You died that we can say it is well. Amen. Amen. God, thank you. Thank you for worshiping with us today. I just love being in the presence of the God. I don't know about you, but sometimes it's just really, really good, isn't it? Amen. Thank you so much for being here. You're going to... I am so excited to hear Gene preach, and I just learned your name this morning. So let's give Gene a big hand as he comes to share the word with us. I know we'll be great.
Well, is it a delight to be here with you all? I've been looking forward to this for a little while, since Les invited me to come. And so I've kind of anticipated it. I've met some of the folks from this church because they have come to Brandon and to Jackson area. And I've taken them, or we have gone to eat at the best catfish place in all the world. And they will tell you that. But at any rate, it's good to see them again, some of them, and to see all of you here. And I am delighted that, you know, Dorothy and I have 5 children. We have 4 girls. And our oldest daughter has come in, and she's sitting here with our great-granddaughter, Ollie. And then, of course, Paige is, Gina's the oldest, Paige is next, and then Dawn, and then Chip, and then Hope. She's number 5. She came 13 years after the others, and she is the one that has kept us young. And so we're thrilled to have them here to be a part of the service as well. And just a delight to be here. I appreciate Les inviting me, giving me the opportunity to come and to share in this time, and so I'm glad. Today is Memorial Day. I don't know about you, but I've been watching the TV, and particularly Fox, and the recognition of Memorial Day. I really like that kind of thing. I want to tell you, I think patriotism needs to rise again. It upsets me when I see some of these folks that do not thank God for America. I just thank God that I am an American, and I'm grateful to be here and to thank the Lord for those people that made it possible. You know, Memorial Day is a time to honor and to remember those folks that paid the price so that we could have the freedoms that we have. And those freedoms are unfortunately eroding away, it seems to me. But that's what Memorial Day is all about. And so I'm so thrilled with the programming that I've seen earlier today. At the same time, you know, when you come to church on a Sunday, you know what you're doing? You're remembering the resurrection. We meet on the first day of the week because Jesus was raised on the first day of the week. And so, in a very real sense, our meeting is a memorial. The Lord's Supper, of course, is a memorial. Jesus says, as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you do it in remembrance of me. And that's a memorial. And then I get to thinking about the fact that, you know, this facility, these facilities, and you've got a great plant here. That's the way preachers sometimes refer to buildings, church plants. But you've got a great facility here. Somebody paid a price back yonder so we could be here. They established it, and now it's here, and you have responsibility for carrying on what they started. And so we're here to talk about Memorial Day. The text that I've chosen is in Joshua, and it's in chapter 3 and chapter 4, and it has reference to memorial. For as we look at this, what we find is that Joshua is leading the children of Israel. Finally, after they have wandered for 40 years, now they're about to enter into the promised land. And as they move into the promised land, they have to cross the Jordan River. The problem is that the Jordan River is flooded this season of the year, and so you can imagine the challenge that was. But God told them what to do, and as we look at this scripture, I want you to notice how many times the word memorial occurs. For example, in Joshua chapter 4, I'm going to read verses 1 through 9, and listen to the times it occurs in here. When all the people were safely across the river, the Lord said to Joshua, "Now choose 12 men, one from each tribe. Tell the men to take 12 stones from where the priests are standing in the middle of the Jordan and pile them up at the place where you camp tonight. So Joshua called together the 12 men and told them, go into the middle of the Jordan in front of the ark of the Lord your God. Each of you must pick up one stone and carry it out on your shoulder. 12 stones in all, one for each of the 12 tribes. We will use these stones to build a memorial in the future your children will ask. What do these stones mean to you? Then you can tell them, they remind us that the Jordan River stopped flowing when the Ark of the Lord's Covenant went across. These stones stand as a permanent memorial among the people of Israel. So the men did as Joshua told them. They took 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan River, one for each of the tribe, for each tribe, just as the Lord had commanded Joshua. Then they carried them to the place where they camped for the night and constructed the memorial there. Joshua also built another memorial of 12 stones in the middle of the Jordan at the place where the priest who carried the Ark of the Covenant were standing. The memorial remains there to this day. I don't know if you counted, but 5 times it talks about a memorial. They are remembering, these stones are here for them to remember what God had done and to carry that message on into the future. The story goes on down in verse 20 and 24. It was there at Gilgal that Joshua piled up the 12 stones taken from the Jordan River. Then Joshua said to the Israelites, in the future, your children will ask, what do these stones mean? Then you can tell them, this is where the Israelites crossed the Jordan on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the river right before your eyes, and he kept it dry until you were all across, just as he did at the Red Sea when he dried it up until we had all crossed over. He did this so that all the nations of the earth might know the power of the Lord and that you may fear the Lord your God. And so as we come to Memorial Day, I think it's fitting to look at this memorial. And what can we learn from this? I think there are several lessons that we can learn out of this passage. I want to begin by focusing on the miracle. I mean, this is a phenomenal miracle. I mentioned to you that the water was flooding at this season of the year. So it was an unbelievable work that God did, this miracle. And it's obvious in that the water stopped when they were going across. And then once they all got across, the water started again. Now, when you read the text, particularly here in chapter 3, here's what it says. So it came about when the people set out from their tents to cross the Jordan, when the priest carrying the Ark of the Covenant before the people, and when those who carried the Ark came into the Jordan, and the feet of the priest carrying the Ark were dipped in the edge of the water, for the Jordan overflows all its banks all the days of harvest, that the waters which were flowing down from above stood and rose up in one heap, a great distance away at Adam or Adam, the city that is beside Zarethan, and those which are flowing down toward the Sea of the Arabah, or the Salt Sea, were completely cut off. So the people crossed opposite Jericho, and the priest who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood firm on firm ground, dry ground, in the middle of the Jordan, while all Israel crossed on dry ground until the nation had finished crossing. Now, think about this. The water was dammed up or was stopped at Adam or Adam, which is considerably north. And then, just as a priest stepped into the water, then the water went on past them, and so they were on dry ground. The miracle is not that God stopped the water altogether, although that is, but it is the fact that he timed it so that when he stopped the water, it was going to perfectly coincide when they stepped into the water. And then when they got to the other side, when they stepped out of the water, he had released the water in advance so that the water began to flow at the very moment they stepped out. The whole idea here is to show this is not some natural phenomenon. I mean, the Jordan River has been dammed up before. I mean, not often, but it has. But this event occurred in such a way as to leave no doubt that God was orchestrating every detail of it. And I think when God does something great like that, we need to acknowledge that. And you know, it's interesting, the centerpiece of this narrative is the Ark. We read several times it's called the Ark. It's called the Ark of the Covenant. It's called the Ark of the Lord. The Ark contained the Ten Commandments, the jar of manna, and Aaron's rod that budded. But the significance of the Ark is it constituted or represented the presence of God. I want you to hear that. It's the presence of God. The Ark itself is not, it doesn't have power. It is the God who is associated and resides in the Ark that has the power. And it's important for us to learn this as we move forward here. This Ark was so holy, you couldn't touch it. You remember that Uzzah touched it, what happened to him? I mean, they were to stay back 3,600 feet from it. That's a half mile. I mean, that God wanted them to represent, to recognize his holiness, and so they didn't get close to that Ark because they knew what would happen. And they obeyed. When that Ark set out, then God was leading them, and they set out. For 40 years, they followed that Ark. When the Ark stopped, they stopped. The whole idea is, are you following the leadership of God in your life, or are you doing what you think you want to do the way you want to do it? We need to be obeying God. They obeyed God, and that Ark represented God's presence in guiding them in their lives. And so, another interesting idea that comes out of this is the wording that's used here. The word that is used in this text is crossover. I read it several times. I don't know if you noticed, but it's used 21 times in these verses, chapter 3, verse 1 through chapter 5, verse 1. Now, that is a different word from what had been used during the journey that Israel was making to the promised land. As they were making their journey, the word nasa was used, and it had the idea of to go forward or to set out. So they set out, but now they have arrived at the place where they were going. And so it's a different word. Abar is used, and it implies crossing over a boundary. It can be a physical boundary, like like a river, that's a boundary. It can refer to a political boundary, like going from one country into another country. It can refer to a moral boundary, like entering into a covenant. And in this particular case, they are crossing over a boundary. It is the river, a physical boundary. It is a national boundary. They're going into a land that they haven't known before. But they are entering into a new time and a new experience with God as God gives them this promised land. The whole idea here is that as they obey God, God is able to bless and does bless them. And so these people did what their ancestors did not do. You remember at Kadesh Barnea, they came to that place and they sent out some spies, 12 of them. But when they came back and gave the report, they did not believe God and they did not move in and take the land. What's the difference here? These people are looking at a flooded river, but they have the faith to believe that God is going to lead them through. And when they obey God and are obedient to him, what happens? They see what God can do. Now, I think there's an application in our life. When we are obeying God, when we are following God, and we walk by faith, not by sight. So many times, I've been in church life for a long time, and folks say, well, I just don't see how we can do that. And I say, you're right, we can't. But we serve a God who can. And God is leading us, and so we need to obey him and depend upon him. And when it happens, who gets the glory? God does. Too oftentimes, we want to do things that we can do, and we get the glory. But God is not about glorifying you and me. He's about glorifying himself. And so we need to be obedient to him. So we've got the miracle. But what about the memorial? Well, here in verses 1 through 9 of chapter 4, we see that there are two different sets of stones that are established. Joshua commands 12 men to take a stone out of the middle and put it on their shoulder. Now, when they put it on their shoulder, what that implies to me, they didn't pick up a big rock. They picked up a boulder. They picked up something big enough that they had to carry it on their shoulders, and then they carried carried it a considerable distance to Gilgal, where they were going to spend the night. And so he sets up these 12 stones there. And then he gives orders that they are to set up another 12 stones in the middle of the river. Interesting, isn't it? Not just the one on the land, but the one in the middle of the river as well. And so these memorials were to remind those who were coming behind them of what God had done for Israel on that day. This is a testimony to what God has done. And so as they reflect and remember back to what God has done there, then they can have the faith and the confidence that God is going to go and do greater things in the days ahead. They can trust Him to do exactly that. And so as we look at these memorials, I think there are several ideas or possibly purposes behind them. They were to serve as a reminder to Israel of God's providence and God's faithfulness. In other words, they had a responsibility to remember how God has met their needs in the past. God had brought them out of the land of Egypt, and He is now bringing them in to the promised land, which He had promised, a land flowing with milk and honey. This was the culmination of God's promise made so long ago, and that's exactly what's happening. There is a danger that we face of forgetting. I mean, when you read the history of Israel in the Old Testament, particularly the wilderness wandering, how often did they forget? They forgot the Red Sea. They forgot how God changed the water at Marah into sweet water. They forgot how God brought water out of rock. They're always forgetting what God has done. They're not obeying. They're not remembering God's ability, but then also God's faithfulness. And God warned them. In Deuteronomy, here's what He says. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land He has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe His commands, His laws, and His decrees that I'm giving you today. And again in verse 19 of chapter 8, He says, if you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you will surely be destroyed. Now, as I have read how Israel was prone to forget, I'm also made aware of how this nation, as a people, have forgotten. I mean, we have, you know, one nation under God, but the fact of the matter is there is a majority even now of people in this country who do not even believe in God. I mean, they're making no bones about it. They're attacking everything that is representative of God. And it's imperative that you and I, as the followers of Christ, exalt His name, stand up for Him, and do those things that are right, regardless if nobody else does them. And I think this is a lesson that we need to learn here. It's so easy to forget. You know, even in our own personal life. I don't know about you, but I've had some times when God met my needs at the very last moment, but He met my needs. And through these years, that has inspired me and encouraged me to do other things that I didn't think I could do, but with God's help, I knew it could be done, and the Lord has met those needs as well. I tell everybody, Dorothy and I have 5 children. They're all bought and paid for. I mean, all of them have, I told them, I pay for the first degree. They all went to college. They all have a degree. I said, and then you pay for the one beyond that. And a number of them have gotten other degrees as well. But my whole point is, I started out making $65 a week at the first church I served, but they had a pastor house for me to live in. But I had a job making $150 a week that I quit to do that job. And through these years, I want to tell you, the salaries didn't increase that much, but God's faithfulness did. And we tithe, we paid, we gave to God what we knew we were supposed to and grew in that. And somehow through all of this, God enabled us to get our children grown and educated, and we are so proud of them today. It's a testimony to what God can do, not what Dorothy and I were able to do. And that's what I'm trying to teach you. I'm trying to help you understand. When you put God first and you obey Him, He will meet all your needs. And that's what this story is all about. Now, the other thing is, this story is to encourage instruction. I don't know if you picked up on this, but this question, what do these stones mean, is asked twice in this passage. It's asked, first of all, when they, in verses 1 through 9, but it's asked also down in verses 14 and following here. What do these stones mean? And the stones were to allow the next generation to be educated as to the glory and the work of God in the previous generation. Someone has said the greatest enemy of faith is forgetfulness. And I think it's true. That's what we've been talking about. You can't forget. You need to remember how God has done, what God has done. You know, God never changes. I mean, circumstances change. Our situations change. But God is always the same. And He is just as faithful today as He has ever been. And He will always be the same. And so the memorial stones teach that God is faithful, but they also teach that God doesn't do miracles like this every day. I mean, think about this. I mean, this is a rarity. Crossing the Red Sea was a unique experience. Crossing the Jordan River was a unique experience. Can God intervene in history and do those kinds of things? Absolutely. But what does He do most of the time? Most of the time, God does His miracles through His people. And that's exactly what we have here. I mean, God is expecting Christian parents and grandparents to instruct and train their children about Him and what He expects of them. Listen to what it says in Psalm 78, verses 5 through 7. He decreed the statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which He commanded our forefathers to teach their children so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born. And they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget His deeds, but would keep His commands. I'm thinking now, you know, one of the biggest problems we have in America is the fact that we have failed the generations behind us. As a consequence of the fatherlessness that we have, as a consequence of a lot of other things focusing on this world, our children have not been trained. They have not been taught the way God has told us to do. And we need to seize every moment. For example, let's assume that 100 years later, granddaddy takes his grandbaby and they go down to Gilgal National Park. And when they get there, the child sees this big pile of stones. He goes running over there to it, and he says, "Granddaddy, what do these stones mean?" That is what we refer to as a teachable moment. What's he going to tell them? He's going to tell them, well, these stones came out of the middle of that water, and they were able to get them out of the middle of that water because God stopped the water and allowed the people of Israel to cross over on dry ground. And now we have put them here so as to remember what God has done. But we need to teach those coming behind us, and they're never too young to learn. I'm just telling you, one of the things my sweet wife did while she was with us is she always invested in our children, in our grandchildren, and in our great-grandchildren. And whatever they become, in large part, is going to be because of the investment of the teaching, the instruction that she placed into them. And so what we find then is that that's a responsibility. We have that responsibility. You can't, I think for a while we thought, well, the school is going to teach morals, or the school is going to do this or that. I'm telling you folks, don't depend on the educational system to teach the morality that these youngsters need. Don't depend on somebody else to do what God has commanded you to do. And in particular, if you're a husband or a grandfather, God said for you to do it, not your wife. I mean, He says that the fathers are the ones that are going to be supposed to be teaching the children. And that's a responsibility that many men have abdicated, and as a consequence, we are seeing some of the circumstances that we have today. So we need to do it. So here's the miracle. Here's the memorial. What message do we get out of this? Well, I think there are a couple of things. We ask the question, what do these stones mean today? Do these stones, this message, this scripture, does it have any kind of bearing on our lives today? And I think there are a couple of things. Number one, I told you that it was interesting they put those stones out in the middle of it. They had a pile out in the middle of the water. What in the world would that be for? Well, I don't know this, but I can imagine that one of the applications would be, hey, this is a boundary. You can't go back. You don't need to go back. I mean, you need to keep your eyes forward and continue to do what God has called you to do. And so those stones are saying, you know, Egypt, you can't go back. Yet they kept wanting to go back to Egypt. And he's saying, no, this boundary here, these rocks here, this is a boundary that says you can't and you ought not to go back. And you know what? As followers of Christ, we have the same thing. I mean, we can't and we ought not go back to the way we were, the way we lived before. Every time we take the Lord's Supper, it is a reminder that our sins have been forgiven. They're under the blood of Jesus, and we dare not go back into that way of life again. In fact, Paul says in Romans 6, for we died and were buried with Christ by baptism, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives. The challenge is to live to honor God today and not go back to the way we were before. But one of the dangers that we face is that the flesh is strong and we have to war against it. We're in spiritual warfare, and so we have to continue moving forward to what God wants us to do. The other thing is that these stones at Gilgal, they gave a witness of the presence and power of God in the life of Israel, and they were there to assure them that they still had work to do. The land was not conquered. They still had these tribes that were living there, and they had to defeat them in order to achieve what God had for them. But it's interesting, they would go and make an escapade, and then they would come back to Gilgal. Read it. I mean, it's all the way through there. They would come back to Gilgal. Why would they do that? I think in part so that they would be reminded, you know, if God could stop the Jordan River, then he can give the Canaanites into our hands. God will give, and by the way, there are several times when God intervenes to give them victory when they had no way of knowing that's what God was going to do. And so what we find is that these stones were a reminder to them that they still had work to do. And I think, as I'll say in a moment, we do as well. There is a danger here that I think has happened to them, and it happens to a lot of people today. And the danger is that we need to guard against worshiping the place. I mean, the source of the power is in God, not in those stones, or not in Gilgal. But what you find is that they made the place a shrine, and they forgot God. And it's so easy for that to happen. In the book of Amos, it says this. This is what the Lord says to the house of Israel. Seek me and live. Do not seek Bethel. Do not go to Gilgal. Do not journey to Beersheba. For Gilgal will surely go into exile, and Bethel will be reduced to nothing. Seeking God, cultivating a walk with God, is what's most important. Now, unfortunately, through these years, I have seen in churches today, they build a magnificent facility like what you have right here. And the people think this building is the source of our strength, but it's not. We come here to meet with God. God is always the source of our strength. But we need to thank God that he gives us facilities, but we don't need to worship the facilities. I'm trusting that you don't, but I want to tell you, I've been in some churches that did. I mean, the building was all important. I mean, they would take care of the building and forget or not do anything about evangelism or try to reach out in the community or make disciples, because the building, that was theirs. Are you listening? This building ain't yours. It was dedicated to God, I'm assuming, when you built it, and this is God's facility. Now, what God wants you and me to do is to thank him that we have a facility that to come into. But to remember, we're here to meet with God. And once we meet with God, He sends us out to do the work that He's called the church to do. And we need to be faithful about doing what He has called us to do. So these stones also testified to Israel that they were on mission, and you and I are on mission. What is our mission, by the way? It's very simple. Jesus said, as you're going, make disciples. Friends, I want to tell you that too many people have forgotten that the mission is not to build a church. The mission is not to have a good time. The mission is not about us at all. The mission is about those people outside who need to know Jesus. And we are to introduce them to Christ and then help them to grow in Christ, making disciples. That's what we're to be about. And as we focus on that and we read scriptures like these, we can take great comfort and hope in the fact that the God that we serve, the God that we know, is just as powerful to do for us as He was to do for these folks in Scripture. And He wants to do all that we need and more besides. And so I think it's good on a Memorial Day to honor and remember those who've sacrificed for us. But it's even more important for us to remember that it is God Himself who is the source of all our strength, all our resources. They are in Him. And so we need to constantly cultivate our relationship with Him. And we need to grow in our faith. We need to more and more become what He wants us to be. And more we need to honor Him. And that only happens when we turn our eyes to Jesus and put our eyes upon Him and walk with Him day by day. So what about it today? What kind of a relationship do you have with Jesus? Do you have a relationship with Jesus? You know, it's amazing how many people have a relationship with the church, but they don't have a relationship with Jesus. I joined the church. Well, I got baptized. That's not the question. The question is, what about your personal relationship with Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? If you have not ever established that relationship, I want to tell you that's the most important decision you'll ever make, because that's going to determine whether you go to heaven or hell. And you need to say yes to Jesus if you have not. Well, let's say, oh, I said yes to Jesus. I'm a believer. Are you walking with Him? Are you allowing Him to lead you and guide you? Are you telling other people about Him? Are you spending time with Him on a daily basis in His Word? Are you closer to Jesus today than you were this time last year, last month? I want to tell you, it is a constant experience and of intentionality to want to walk closer to Jesus every day. And I'm praying that God will help me to do that. I want to know what He wants, and I want to do what He wants me to do. But the only way I can do that is if I am intentionally seeking Him and seeking to live for Him. One of the things that has happened in me over the last several months, actually it's not even 2 months since Dorothy passed, but is that I have come to see that you have to have a singular vision of Jesus and heaven, and you need to live for heaven and not for here. It's so easy to live, to pay the bills, to get this goal accomplished or to do other. But here's what I want you to know. Everything that you get here, you're going to leave here. Everything that you lay up there, you'll have with you. Live for heaven. Don't live for this world and yourself. Okay? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this day. And we're grateful for Your faithfulness to Your Word. Lord, thank You for a wonderful story like we read this morning and how You amaze us at what You have done and can do. And Lord, I pray that you will help us to learn some lessons from it today. And Lord, you know each one of us. You know where we are in our walk with you. Lord, if there are those that you want to call into a closer walk with you, let them say yes to you today. And in this time of response, in just a moment, Lord, I pray they'll come and kneel here at this altar and renew their personal commitment to you. Father, if there's someone here who has not ever established a personal relationship with you by faith in surrendering their life to you as Lord and Savior, help them to do that today. Lord, lead them, give them the courage and the strength to do what you want them to do. May your will be done in their heart and their life right now. And lead us all, Lord, in this time of response to renew our faith and commitment to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Just a moment, we're going to have a time of response. And as I indicated in the prayer just now, if you want to come to this altar, then certainly come to the altar. But if you need to talk with someone, we'll be available here. Someone will be available to pray with you, talk with you, and guide you and lead you in whatever decision you want to make. Let's stand together, and Brother Lester will come and lead us.
And here's the thing I'd like you to focus on for these moments, okay? I love what Brother Gene just said about living right now with eternity in mind. So whatever that means to you, meaning, have you committed your life to the Lord Jesus? Or are you just living to do the day-to-day here? Then you could settle that today by giving your life to Christ and coming and repenting of sin, confessing that and asking for his forgiveness today, and he'll hear you and he'll respond and give you the gift of eternal life. And if anybody needs any help in doing that, I'll be down here for the next few moments as we sing together. And then if you already have committed your life to Christ and you follow Jesus, but truthfully, if you're honest, you would say, yeah, you know, I've lost that sense of eternity and I've been focusing on the wrong things, then today that can change. So why don't you recommit your life to living now, but living with eternity in mind, whatever that means for you, as you lead us, Charles Queen.
All to Jesus I surrender.
Today it's been great to have you, Gene. Thank you so much for bringing a message to us, and I hope we can live that out. Les, I know you're anxious to get back in the saddle again next week. We'll look forward to having you back with us as well. It's been a couple weeks now, so just be ready for it, church. I'm just saying. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday. You call my name.